Good morning. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome, beloved community. Welcome to this sacred time of worship with the Forest Grove United Church of Christ, where because of the good news and the love of God we see in Jesus, we see and celebrate the light of Christ shining in you and in each other. We see it shining in people of all gender expressions, in all forms of love, in all forms and traditions of wisdom. We see it shining in you no matter your mental health challenge, your immigration status, whether you have a 401k or 401 cents. We see it shining in you because you, just as you were made, are a beloved child of God. And so we welcome you into this time of worship. And we say to you that the light of Christ in us sees and celebrates the light of Christ in you. I want to let us know that this morning we are kicking off our 2021 stewardship campaign. And our theme this year is building the beloved community, strengthening the body of Christ together. And I want to thank all of you who are helping with this effort. And I want to remind us that in the mail we'll be receiving a packet with a stewardship letter, a sheet with financial information about the church, as well as a pledge card. Pledge cards are going to be due back at the church office by November 5th. Remember the 5th of November, as they say, and we will dedicate our pledge cards on the 8th of November when we wrap up the culmination of our 2021 stewardship campaign with Reverend Tyler Connolly as our guest speaker. He is our conference minister, and he'll be offering the sermon on that Sunday. Also, I want to remind you that we have begun having small in-person spiritual gatherings on Saturday mornings. If you want to participate in these gatherings, I ask that you please RSVP. To learn more about these gatherings and the safety measures that we're taking for these gatherings, I encourage you to please read the announcements. God of peace, be with those who guide the destinies of the world so that an end may come to boasting and vainglory and the reign of arrogance dwindle in our time. Give them the courage to speak the truth and the humility to listen. Help us all to put the good of others above our own ambitions and the truth which does not profit us above the lie that does. So may we stand upright, freed from the burden of fear and the weight of suspicion, learning to trust each other. Help each one of us to bring our own offering of understanding and our own sacrifice for peace, so that we are at peace with ourselves and live in peace with those around us. Then in tranquility, may we all go forward to build your kingdom in the world until the earth shall be filled with your wisdom as the waters cover the sea. And so we light our candle of peace. And enter this time of worship. Amen.
Sing the goodness of our God.
We lift up Sue Grossman in our prayers today. Also Russ and Anne Dondero. Russ has a surgery coming up. And we also keep in our prayers today James and Patricia Spears. Let us pray. God of abundant blessings, we give thanks for the overflowing of life of which we are all a part. Fill us with the peace that comes with the knowledge that we are a part of your creation. Bless us with this knowledge that each day we can rest our minds, our hearts, and our whole being in the fullness of your greater life in which we live and move and have our being. Let your overflowing light overflow within and through us. Your living water carry us. The stability and richness of the earth uphold and nurture us, and nurture others through us. The brightness of the flame of your spirit shine and dance in us and in our lives. The song of your compassion be sung in all that we do. Open our eyes to the abounding simple blessings of each day so we can emulate and magnify giving and sharing and generosity and all that is your greater life in everything we do. And may our humble efforts praise you and all life. In times of isolation and disconnection, we give thanks for community and public institutions that uphold the common good. In times of ignorance and the deterioration of reason and common sense, we give thanks for our ability to be a place of education and enlightenment and learning. For all those who are sick, we pray for healing. For all those who are lonely, comfort them with the knowledge that your warmth, your love, and the care of this community and all of our prayers hug them at all times. For all those facing endings and transitions, we ask that your spirit inspire their minds to open to infinite possibilities and bless them with the peace of amazement. Give us all a sense of urgency to see all the blessings of our lives and of this community and the opportunity we have to be your church so we can treasure these blessings, so we can share them with each other and continue to be a field of blessing for this world as the Forest Grove United Church of Christ. We ask all this in the name of Jesus, who is our eternal blessing, who taught us how to pray, saying, "Our Creator, our Father, great Mother in whom is heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
Malachi, through 1 through 8, to 3, to 6, to 12. When you offer blind animals in sacrifice, is not that wrong? And when you offer those that are lame or sick, is that not wrong? Try presenting that to your governor. Will he be pleased with you or show your favor, said the Lord of the host. For I, the Lord, do not change. Therefore you, O children of Jacob, have not perished. Ever since the days of your ancestors, you have to turn aside from my statutes. And I have not kept them. Return to me. I will return to you, said the Lord of the host. But you say, how shall we return? Will anyone rob God? Yet you're robbing me. But you say, how are we robbing you? In your tithes and offerings, you are cursed with a curse. For you are robbing me with the whole nation. bring the full tithe into our storehouse, so that they may be food in my house. Thus put me to the test, says Lord of the host. See if you will not open the windows of heaven. For you pour me down, for you are overflowing blessing. I will rebuke the locusts for you, so that you'll not destroy the produce of your soil. And your vine and field shall not be barren, says the Lord of the host. Then all the nations will count you happy, for you will be the land of delight, says the Lord of the host. Proverbs 28-27. Whoever gives you to the poor will lack nothing. But the one that turns a blind eye will get many a curse.
How much blessing do we all want in our lives? This is the question that the prophet Malachi asks the Israelites who had just recently returned from exile in the scripture we heard this morning. God had just carried the people of God through adversity once again, and once again in their re-established comfort, they soon forget the source of all their blessings. The priests begin to hold on to the best for themselves and store up excess. Instead of giving the best offerings to the temple to be shared, and in those days that might have been a strong, healthy bull, they offer up a sick calf. They give what they would never want for themselves. The words of the prophet and the wisdom from the proverb this morning warn us that when we hold on to our resources and live only for ourselves, we invite many a curse. But when we share with one another, when we give of our resources, we ensure mutual blessing. We welcome God into our lives, and we lack nothing. So as we begin our 2021 stewardship campaign today, I want to ask all of us, how much blessing do we want in our lives? How much blessing do we want for each other and our community? When we discern our pledge, are we just going to offer the sick calf with the gimpy leg, or are we going to share a healthy bull? The nature of our gift measures the blessing we are willing to receive for ourselves and for this beloved community of which we are a part. Our consumer culture does not teach us that joy and true blessing come when we share our resources and give away what we have for the benefit of the whole. That's not something we generally learn in our society. On the contrary, I think we are programmed to function more from a mindset of scarcity in our culture. But the prophet this morning tells us that when we function in this way and withhold excess from the collective, whatever that means for us, we actually, quote, rob from God. So what is this curse of which the prophets speak? What does it mean to rob God? These might sound like harsh and judgmental words. They might be a turnoff to some of us, so I want to give these words some context. I want to clarify that God does not put this curse on us. The curse that the prophets speak about this morning is one we invite and create together. It creeps up on us slowly. It starts when we get comfortable. At that point, when we get comfortable, maybe a few of us start taking more than we probably need. And all together, we take a step or two away from God. A trend takes hold. Other people start thinking or feeling there won't be enough to go around. Everyone starts holding on to what they have. And we all take a few more steps away from each other at that point. The ethic, every man for himself, replaces concern and care for neighbor. And together we take a leap away from God. We all begin to assume that our neighbors don't care about us. Fear and distrust take hold in the heart. Closed hearts become locked doors and walls. The poor among us starve, and so does God. People become isolated from one another. Even those of us who have managed to win the game of accumulating the most and holding on to the most find ourselves alone in our castles, feeling depressed and empty. Most of us live on guard against each other, trying to make sure we can get ours. Rather than seeing one another as the image of God, we become as valuable to one another as a pop-up advertisement on a digital screen. This is the curse that we create together. One morning we wake up and wonder how we've created a society where love and compassion have come to be considered radical and extremist ideas. A society where the only institutions that exist are ones trying to sell us something. A world where no one cares about their neighbors and where young people despair before they get old. A world where we find ourselves wondering all the time, where is God? God says to humanity, through the prophet this morning, return to me and I will return to you. That's what God says through the prophet, return to me and I will return to you. The good news is that if we distance ourselves from God by living only for ourselves and holding on to more than we need, we know that we run back into the arms of God when we share with one another and give of our financial resources, our time, and our talents to benefit the whole. The wisdom of our tradition encourages generosity, saying that when we give, we actually wind up lacking nothing. If holding on to our treasure for ourselves invites the curse, then sharing together ensures the blessing. Our giving, far from being a burden, can be felt as a joyful and triumphant act, a return to God. In ancient Israel, every 49 years were marked as Jubilee years, literally meaning years of joy and triumph. During Jubilee years, slaves and prisoners would be freed, land would be redistributed, debts would be forgiven. This practice of sharing, of pouring out wealth on each other, was understood as a welcoming of God's grace and mercy. If the amount we withhold for ourselves measures our distance from God, the amount we share with the whole measures our closeness to God, and the amount of blessing we are ready to welcome into our shared life together, which is actually our only true life. This year, as a congregation, we have adopted the stewardship theme of building the beloved community, strengthening the body of Christ together. In a society where we are trained to function out of scarcity, our sharing resources to support the life and ministry of this beloved community of this church is perhaps one of the most direct and immediate ways we have of doing that, of building that beloved community. So as we discern how much we will give of our financial resources and or our time and our talents this year, I want each of us to ask ourselves this question. How much blessing. How much blessing do I want to welcome into my life? The giving and sharing of our resources allows us to be the blessing for a society sick with the curse that the prophets warned against. Our giving enables us as the church to be like an embassy of the realm of God, an oasis, a field of blessing. The measure of our gift determines how big that oasis of blessing can be. In our giving, we have an opportunity to welcome abundant blessings and be that blessing for our world together. How much blessing do you want to be? How much do you want to make the golden rule mainstream and great again? How many people do you want to know they are made in the image of God, and that their lives matter, and that they have purpose, and that they are deeply loved? How much meaning-making and forgiveness and healing and reconciliation do you want for our community and for our children? How many hungry and thirsty people fed and clothed? How many strangers welcomed and given shelter? In a world where compassion has become considered radical and extreme, how much do you want our neighbors to remember compassion to be the life and guiding presence of God in our lives? How much abundant understanding and mutual support? How much community? How much friendship? How much wisdom and learning? How many places and spaces where people are treated like children of God? How much blessing do you want to see around you? How much blessing do you want to be? How big do you want that beloved community where people of all identities and walks of life stand hand in hand with each other and hand in hand with God? Truly, when we give and share our resources together, we return to God. We welcome all these possibilities, all these blessings. How much blessing do you want to welcome? This is the question I encourage us all to meditate upon in the coming weeks as we discern whether our gift will be the sick calf with the gimpy leg or the healthy bull. Until then, may God's blessings inspire us to give generously to support the life and ministry of this church in the form of our pledge, that we might welcome the abundant life of God for ourselves and for each other. Amen.
Good morning to you. They have asked me to do the witness for stewardship this week. I'm in a real unfamiliar place. I would much rather have a wheelbarrow full of dirt and fire and some kids sitting around me. I have never spoken to the adults on an adult level. I've always come through the children's perspective. So this will be challenging for me. Very emotional because the church means so much. A little bit of the history. Gail and I met in church in the ninth grade in the Disciples of Christ First Christian Church in Corvallis in the ninth grade. She was smart enough not to date me till we were in college. Thank goodness. We graduated from Oregon State in the 1970s. In 1975, we came to Forest Grove. There was a member of our church in Corvallis that said, you need to try out the UCC church in Forest Grove. We came here, joined a young adult fellowship group, got active in the learning community, which was all the classes together participating. Church became so easy. I do not know a time in my life when I wasn't in church. My parents were churchgoers. I was raised in the church. My mother is gone. My dad is still participating in church as of now without the pandemic. How has this church influenced my life? Staggering, absolutely staggering. The challenges of life come at you no matter what. You can try and hide in church or out of church, but the challenges of life will happen. The number one challenge for Gail and I, we were not able to have children. So we went through the roller coaster ride of up and downs, getting children. Absolutely an emotional ride that's crushing, and highs and lows both. This church helped get us through that. Both our son and our daughter had special challenges during that process. Church members came and hugged us when we were crushed, and got us through those times. We were able to raise two adult children, great kids, great adults, and we're all because of this church. They were both active in the youth group. Stewardship-wise, Gail and I have sat down prayerfully each year when it was time to decide what we were to do for the church. Not only money, it takes money to have the building and the staff, we all know that, but what we would like to participate in and do for the church and with the church. Gail has chosen her activities. She loves the memorial services. She was a teacher, special talents with young children. She taught for years and years and years. I've chosen to be usher, bell ringer, anything to do that I get to meet people. I'm not a very good sit with my hands in my pockets and talk about things. I need to be out doing things. I want to be on the roof clearing leaves, or I want to be doing something. We each choose our own activities, but we try and participate in them together as a family. Gail and I are now a family. Church will always be in my life. This church is not just the building. Whether I can be here or not someday, there's a lot of us that can't come to church each Sunday because of physical means or other barriers that keep us from being here. Emotionally, church will always be with us, with me, with Gail, our family. I can't imagine life without the church. It gives me something not only to know what day of the week it is, but to vent my activities, vent my need to do things with people. These are the nicest people in the world around us. They're like family. Every day is a family gathering on Sunday. My family is 80-some people. Gail's family is 100-and-some people. These are our family, too. Every Sunday, I see your pictures. You can't see them, but they're all right in front of me, and I can put names on almost every one of you. You are family. So when it's time to decide what to do with church, sit prayerfully, sit mindfully, know how much it means to each one of you individually. Challenge yourselves to do what you can, not only monetarily, but emotionally and physically for the church. Thank you for this opportunity. It's absolutely, I'm shaking like a leaf up here. It's a special moment to get to talk to adults. Thank you.
We give thanks for that beautiful and heartfelt testimony. And now at this point, the morning offering will be received. So I invite you to make your morning offering and send that to the church in the way that you are currently doing. Oh.
The breezes and the sunshine, the soft, refreshing rain. All good gifts around us, all sent from heaven above. Thank the Lord, oh, thank the Lord for
thee then, Creator, for all things bright and good, the seed time and the harvest, our life, our health, our food. No gifts have we to offer, for all thy love imparts, but that which thou desirest, our humble, thankful hearts. All good gifts around us are sent from heaven above. So thank the Lord, oh, thank the Lord.
Holy Spirit, we ask that you shower your spirit and your blessings and your life on these gifts and turn us together into your life, your field of blessing for this world. We ask that you use all that we have and all that we are in your service and in the welcoming of the realm of God, which is justice and peace on earth, all around us, in all that we do, to the glory of your name. Amen. Beloved of God, our service has ended, and we go now to love and serve the world in the name of the Creator, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit. As you leave, may you go loving God so much that you love nothing else too much, and fearing God just enough that you need fear nothing else at all. Go in love. Amen.